So the first objective which we've seen is mutual exclusion. How do we achieve mutual exclusion? Through locks. And the key goal in mutual exclusion is that two threads don't run at the same time. Solved using locks. What about ordering? Have we looked at any mechanism by which we can order threads? Queues is giving them a fair chance, but we're still not directly ordering them. I want to explicitly say that A runs before B. How can we do that?
Setting a barrier.
Setting a barrier.
Like, you can explicitly program them.
Okay, how do you explicitly program them? Because threads are scheduled by the OS. We don't even know which of them is going to run first. Does everyone get the question? I want to ensure that A runs after B.
We can have some shared variable which acts as a flag for the other thread. So
okay.
If that thread flag is set, then only I run, and that flag
okay.
is actually set by the one you want.
Good. So we'll come to this in a minute. Have we used something known as join, which we can use here? So join would ensure that the first thread, so join would wait for one of the threads to complete, right? So could we use the notion of join here?
Yes.
Probably can. Solve the join. But how is join implemented? Anyone has a clue?
Park.
So it's going to be somewhat similar to park and unpark, but it's not exactly park and unpark. It's something else. It's known as condition variables, which we'll study in this lecture.
So does join ensure that A runs after B, or does it ensure that A finishes like before?
So join will ensure that A has finished, but before you start executing B, you can call join. You can like wait for that. You can say join of A, something like that. Okay, so here is a question which Varun has already solved, but I want all of you to think for a minute. And so look at this program. We have a child thread and we have a main thread. So we want to ensure that this parent end will come after child as executed. So think of it, how are we going to solve it? Think for a minute. And you're not going to use the join, pthread join. You're not allowed to use that.
In the last slide, how is join helping? Like, we cannot make A run before B. We can only make the main program run after.
So main is also a thread. Similarly, in some of the thread, we can also, let's say this is child 1 and child 2. So before the main execution of child 2 runs, the functions, the phrase in child 2 runs, you call join on. Mona, how are we going to do this? So one way to think of it is to start with, let's say when we were discussing about fork. So in fork, we had to ensure that one of the process runs before the other, what did we do? We use IPC, right? So wait, or we had to use something like some inter-process communication. Why was that necessary? Because fork creates a new copy of the address space, so there is no shared variable. But for threads, do we have shared variables or not? The variables are shared, right? Can we use a shared variable to solve this problem? How will you do that?
Only when the child has been checked, the child definitely sets the variable to
some
value.
Okay.
The variable
is here,
if only when the variable has been changed, then only I can progress.
Okay, so will it be a while, right? So whenever the child is printed, that print as child, so if we give this command, it's a done to one. Flag variable, initialize to 0. So again, don't forget to initialize these variables. And inside the main thread, we'll spin on the done variable. So this is similar to a spin lock in Notion, but the difference being that as such not locking anything, it's just waiting for that thread to execute. So by this mechanism, we'll ensure that the child finishes before the parent continues its execution. But why is this bad? spin waiting, right? It's always wasting a lot of CPU. Okay, so we are initializing set done to one inside, spin waiting for the child to finish. And spin waiting is possible. That is why this is not a good solution. So we now use something known as condition variables. So pay a lot of attention to this slide, because the following slides are going to depend upon the understanding of this. So condition variable is a queue of sleeping threads. So some of you had also suggested earlier that we could use Spark to achieve this functionality. This is somewhat similar. So Spark was also allowing us to maintain a queue of sleeping threads. So thread will add themselves to queue with wait. And thread will wake up threads on the queue with signal. So similar to Spark and Unpark, there is something now known as wait and signal. So wait is called by the thread itself, which puts it to sleep. And some other thread now has to wake it up, because it can't wake it up, because the thread which has gone to sleep has to be woken up by some other thread. That's done by a signal. So the basic syntax of this is a condition variable, which is defined using kind underscore t. So this is a p thread implementation. And this is a mutex. So we're also passing it a lock. If you don't understand why we're passing it a lock, just wait 5 minutes and you'll get a better understanding. So whenever the wait is being called, it's assumed that this lock which is being passed is already held by this particular thread. And this will put the caller to sleep, the thread which is calling wait, will put it to sleep, and it will atomically remove the lock. So anyone wants to tell us why do we have to, both of these have to happen atomically? And if you release the lock earlier, then you won't be able to put it to sleep. So that is why both of these need to happen at the same time. And this is the interesting bit. So when it is awoken, so when signal is being called, this particular thread will be awoken. It has to reacquire the lock before returning from this execution of the state. And correspondingly, there is a signal which does not require lock to be passed as an argument. It just requires the same condition variable to be passed. It's going to wake a single waiting thread. Which thread to wake, we don't know as of yet. And if there is no waiting thread, it just returns without doing anything. Okay, so I'll put these definitions here of wake and signal, the same from the previous slide. And this is the same function which we were using in the previous slide. We have a thread underscore exit function, and we have a thread underscore join. So the idea is to use the notion of wait and signal to ensure that the child runs before the main thread continues the execution. So think for about 2-3 minutes on how you implement using condition variables.
So if the child runs before the signal, the thread should acquire the lock, right?
When you pass the
signal, then it should, the new thread which is awoken should reacquire the lock.
So when it's awoken, it reacquires the lock.
So how when you pass signal, how do we know which lock it should be?
This lock is already passed. That's the lock is
waiting. So pass to wait. So my passing signal, how do we know?
So signal and wait are access connected, because they're connected by the condition variable. So there has to be some permutation combination of using wait and signal inside these threads. So you want to implement that. So one hint is that you want which of the function to wait, the main or the child, which of them should wait? The main should wait, right? And when should it wake up? So after the child is completed, right? There should be in thread exit there should be something like signal, and thread join there should be something like wait. But this also requires a mutex. So just write 3-4 lines for each of these thread exit and thread join. It should be able to figure this out. those that you have written, have you written the initialization conditions also? Have you initialized the mutex and the condition variable or not?
Yeah,
okay, so let's look at the solution. It's a fairly simple function. Red exit, you lock, because you have to hold the lock so that you want to ensure that only one of the thread is executing at one particular time. You call signal, and this is defined on some condition variable which is initialized earlier. I'm not showing the initialization. And you unlock after that. That's thread exit. Thread join is again used pretty much the same thing. You call a mutex, you conditionally wait, and you unlock after that. Does it make sense? Anyone who's not understood this? What do you understand?
This the lock and join definition. But how are we using this? Because can you repeat the definition? Upper part.
Okay. So what you want to ensure is that the child runs before this parent end printer is printed. So yeah, okay, so I think this should show you that you understand better. Let's look at the different orderings in which these lines can execute. So do you understand that you require these six lines? Is that clear? But we don't know in which order they're required, or these six lines will suffice or not.
So is the lock over there and the lock over there the same?
Yeah. So you need the same lock which is being passed over to wait, and the same one, essentially the same lock for which the signal will also be used. So we have parent and child. Let's say that X is executed first. So what's potentially happening is the parent process gets the context. It tries to run. It locks that particular thread. You say condition wait. What happens if condition wait is being called? So assumes lock is set. Is that true? Yeah, that's true. Puts the caller to sleep and atomically releases lock. So now the parent or the main thread will be put to sleep and it will also release the lock. So who holds the lock at this point of time when Y has executed? No thread at this point of time. Now A executes, so the child gets hold of the lock. B executes, it says a conditional signal on the condition variables. What does signal do? Wake a single waiting thread. So which was the sleeping thread? Parent one, right? So it wakes. So waking up does not necessarily mean that the parent will execute. It only means that it's now in the ready state. It can execute or it's runnable. Let's go back again. B has executed. Why can't the parent anyway execute at this point of time? Because the lock is being held by this thread. So until and unless C executes, the parent won't be able to run. So C executes, and then when you return from this, what happens? So whenever we call condition wait, let's go back to the definition. When a open requires a lock before returning. So it takes a clock back with it. So you see that here we are unlocking it. So before unlocking, we'll have to hold the lock, right? So it holds the lock, requires a lock after returning from whenever the signal is being called, it executes. It acquires a lock, and during mutex unlock, it again unlocks. So we have this particular order, X, Y, and then A, B, C, and Z. Does this ensure that the child runs before the parent? Yeah, right. So in this order, we can ensure that that the child ran before the parent. Okay, so can you come up with some other order, some other combination of A, B, C, X, Y, Z, in which the child does not necessarily run before the parent? Again, think for 2-3 minutes. write it down in a notebook. And so I would assume it's an atomic instruction. But are you asking then why do we need to lock? Is that the question? Yeah, so this solution by itself is not complete. We need to do something else. So there has to be a shared variable somewhere which we'll require.
So like, what if the child executes first?
Yeah, so you have to find me an order using these six lines where the child won't be able to, where the parent won't execute after the child. So you want to ensure two, three conditions. One of the first condition is that the child completes, the parent then starts executing. So you want that ordering. The second thing is you want the parent to continue. You don't want the parent to sleep indefinitely. That's also a hint to find out an order in which the parent will sleep indefinitely.
A, B, C, X, Y.
A, B, C, and X, Y, Z are wrong. Yeah, you can put any of these. You can put A, X, B, Y, C, Z. You can run any of them. But of course, whenever there's a notion of lock and unlock, that will automatically ensure that they run in a particular fashion. You can try to run them, but if the lock is something that's not of use to you. Okay, Ritvik, tell us an order and parent won't be able to execute after the child. Right. Okay, so what happens if A, B, C executes? So what happens if A executes followed by B executes? So you get acquire the lock. You call signal. What happens if, let's look at the definition again. Signal will make a single waiting thread, and if there's no waiting thread, just return to nothing. A runs, B runs. At this point of time, is there any waiting thread? No. What does this line do then? Nothing, it just goes to the next line. Then you're able to execute C. The mutex is unlocked, the lock is unlocked. After that, X runs. You acquire the lock. You have Y, which is now a conditional wait. And what happens after this? Parent will go to sleep. Why does it sleep indefinitely?
No signal.
Because there is no one to wake it up, right? So is this useful? Is this useful in this current form? No, right? Because it only assumes to work when it will only work in this particular order of execution. And this is a symbol for sleep indefinitely. We'll reuse this symbol again. So the first rule of the thumb is, in addition to condition variables, we have to use another variable to capture the state. The problem with the previous implementation was, we didn't have any variable to capture the state. And the purpose of saving the condition variable is just to nudge the thread when the state changes. So how do you change the state? Like you use a simple variable like done, done equal to 0 or 1. That's the main idea. To use some conditions, to use some state variable to capture the change, in addition to just using conditional variables, to effectively have that order. Let's look at another implementation. So in this, we say that, you know, let's use a done variable, a status variable. And when we call thread exit, whenever the child executes, we set done equal to 1. So we initialize done equal to 0. Done equal to 1. Signal, because now what it says is done equal to 1, the state has changed, child is executed, now the parent can be woken up, and inside the parent, in the thread join function, we set the lock, we check if done equal to 0 or not, and we then do a condition break. So if done equal to 0 means that child is not yet completed, we wait for it. We wait for the child to set done equal to 1, and then we unlock. Okay, so think for about 2-3 minutes again. Will this work, will this not work, and why? Write down the different orders to have a better understanding. So write some A, B, W, Y, Z. And the easiest way to start is to take up some extreme cases. A, B, then W, X, Y, Z, and W, X, Y, Z, and then A, B, and then take something. If the extreme cases or the naive cases fail, then only you should go to the more complicated cases. Work or can you come here and explain? Or stand up and explain? Or be loud and explain?
So, like, first W executes, so main acquires the lock.
Yeah.
Then done is 0, so it goes in the for loop. If condition.
If condition, it goes in.
So, right. Before executing Y, A starts executing.
Okay, so what he's saying is W executes, X executes. But before you come to the wait condition or the wait statement, there is a context switch. A is executed.
So then B executes because it does not require any lock mechanism.
So done is set to 1. Now B executes.
B executes. So there is no thread in the queue, so it just returns.
Yeah, just returns.
Then Y executes and
Y executes.
There is no one to wait.
Yeah. So does everyone see the order? So W executes, gets the lock. X executes, checks done equal to 0. Yes, done equal to 0 is true. X enters into this condition, does a conditional wait. Conditional wait will put itself to the queue, and what is the second thing it does? Atomically release the lock. So the lock is now not being held. The lock can be held by any other thread. And at that instance, unfortunate instance of time, there's a context switch. A gets executed in the child thread. That is set to 1. Condition signal is being called, but condition wait was not being called at this point in time. So done equal to 1 is being called. Now why does done equal to 1 execute at this time? So in the previous cases, we had to wait for the lock, right? In both the child and the parent. But in this particular implementation, child does not have a lock. That is why done equal to 1 can execute. Then we do a conditional signal. And conditional signal will then see if there is any thread waiting on the queue. No thread is waiting on the queue. So it just returns. After that, so A and B are being called. After that, the execution goes back to thread join. And we execute condition wait, which puts itself to sleep, unlocks. But then there is no one to wake it up. So the parent again goes to indefinitely. Does everyone understand this? Sure, does anyone want me to explain this again? This ordering? So this is another failure case. So we have looked at two different failure cases. One where we use the notion of locking and unlocking and some symmetrical code where we have signal and wait, within the exit and the join function. The other one in which in the exit condition we don't have the locking and unlocking, but we have a state variable done. Okay, so let's now look at the correct solution. We have, so it's basically now combining both of these solutions. You have a mutex lock in which you set the done variable to 1. So if you look back to the previous example, the only reason we were able to execute this thread was because there was no thread, there was no lock. That is why we could set done equal to 1. After done is equal to 1, we signal. So that can again wake up the thread after status has been changed. And in this case, I'm using Y instead of F. Anyone knows why? That's a good answer. That so this if condition will fail if there are multiple threads, but in this particular implementation where there is only a single main and single child, if would have worked, but then just to be safe, we're using a while. So if you read the textbook also, they said that some implementations can be spurious, so it's always better to be on the safer side so that you can check the condition again. If you don't understand this, wait for 5 minutes, we'll look at another example where it makes a lot of sense. The second rule of thumb is to always have the control of the lock before you call wait and signal. So again, if you look at it strictly, for wait you strictly require the lock, for signal you do not strictly require the lock. But again, it's a matter of good practice to always work the controls. So we next talk about the producer consumer problem. Anyone heard of this? Caltech interview. Guys, have you now read about this? No? Founded before, Dining Philosopher, all of these are somewhat similar in okay. So it's a very basic problem which we encounter in our daily lives. We have producers, consumer, two types of entities. Producers are going to produce data and place it on some shared resource. So it's important to note this fact that it's placing it on some shared resource. And as an example, let's look at some multi-threaded web server. So what is the producer in a multi-threaded web server? So there has to be some thread or some entity which is producing data. There has to be some thread or entity which is consuming data. So if you have a multi-threaded web server, what is producing the data? The different requests that you're getting, right? So let's say that there is a server and there are thousands of clients who are trying to access the web page. So all of these requests are in some sense producing, are being produced, right? And then there has to be some mechanism or some logic which executes to send a response. So you read a request, you do some logic, let's say you parse what is the content of the request, and then you send a response back. So there is a consumer of the thread and there is a producer thread. Does it make sense? Or is that confusing? Multiple responses are sent concurrently, so those are consumers. Any other analogy of producer-consumer you could use? Think about. One naive which I'm thinking out aloud is, let's say there is some exam. So you people are producing the solutions and the TAs and I am checking the solutions. So you are the producers, you're basically producing the answers, and we're the consumers. So we're looking at the answers or the answer sheets and we are consuming them and some processing them in some way. And in some sense it's a shared resource because it's a shared answer sheet that you've given us. But typically how are answer sheets checked? So they're checked in a very serial fashion, right? First you complete the exam and then the PAs and the instructor check the exam. the equivalent of it in multi-threaded setting would be as and when you're writing the exam. So we're standing beside you on your head, I'm checking the answer. Why would that be a good idea? So the turnaround time would be reduced, right? We don't have to wait for your entire answer sheet to be checked. The other could be you will get some quick feedback on whether you're going to score good or not. So that's the idea. Again, you have some shared resource. Both the producer and the consumer have access to that resource. And you want only one of them to be checking some particular, like let's say if I'm checking your answer sheet, you don't want me to check that same line that you're writing. So what kind of thread mechanism do you want to ensure to be used? Lock, right? So while, let's say lock at a line level, while I'm writing a line, you don't want the other to consume the line. So producer and consumer should not be running at the same time. The other you want to ensure is that, so we'll come to the other example, which typically is referred is called bounded buffer. So let's say we run this graph. Grep of some pattern on file.txt, and then we do a word count. So how do you think this runs? Does the grep finish first and then word count is being called? No? Yes?
Yes.
Yes? So you say that this will first finish, it will produce a stream, and then that stream will be used as an input. That's a perfectly valid solution, but as we've been talking of the notion of can we reduce the turnaround time? So the idea is, as soon as this is starting to process, can we start to consume also? So the grep to file.txt will act as a producer. It will produce some, let's say, stream of bytes. And the other program or the other thread, whichever way it's implemented, will start reading this, and it will start then consuming the data and to produce something. Make sense? What the shared resource in this case? Sorry?
Yeah.
So that's the output, but where is the occurrence stored? That's the important part. It's not stored in a file. So it's stored in some kernel data structure, or you require some kind of shared memory, right?
Buffer.
Shared memory or some buffer. So that's where this is being stored. And it's an example of bounded buffer. So bounded buffer comes from the fact that you cannot consume an empty buffer. And let's say the buffer has some length as in you don't want to produce, you know, 2 GB of buffer and then you want to consume. So let's say you limit the buffer to 2 MB. As soon as the buffer is completed, you'll want the producer to sleep or to stop, right? So that then you can consume some of the produced contents and then you again start producing. So buffer is, okay, just wait for another minute. I'll just show it pictorially. So let's assume that this is some common memory structure or common space. So the producer will put something on the buffer. Let's say it put list of 5 lines from the grep process. So these 5 lines are put here on the buffer now. Or if this is a multi-threaded web server, so these are the 5 requests that your server has. And the consumer will use, I don't know if you notice or not, so this will very slightly reduce the size. So this is because of the consumer consuming the buffer. When does the consumer have to go to sleep? When the buffer is empty, right? Because there is nothing to consume. You don't want the consumer to unnecessarily try and read something which, when something doesn't exist. When does the producer have to go to sleep? On the buffer is full, right? Does it make sense to everyone?
So
buffer full, producer or producer have to wait?
So then purposeful
there is?
So where is purpose to?
So it's in this particular case, it's something known as in kernel bounded buffer. So it's some memory, common memory or. But think of this concept in a more general term. Let's say the exam checking thing only. So in that case, the buffer is your answer sheet. If the buffer is full, then the producer or the producers have to wait. There can be multiple producers. So multiple threads can be accepting requests from a multi-threaded web server. And multiple threads can be returning responses also. And the consumers have to wait the buffer. Can someone explain what this 14-line program is doing? Okay, Aditi, what is this program doing? So if you read the title, you'll get the hint. So this is a very constrained form of bounded buffer problem where the buffer size is only one. So it can hold only a single value. So instead of, you know, declaring an array or some common memory structure, we declare a single variable in buffer which holds the value of that particular buffer content. Count equal to 0, which is the number of entries in the buffer. So count can only be 0 or 1, right? So there are two functions only which we require. Put and get. When will put be run? When can put run?
When we need to push something in the
and when can you push something?
Count is zero.
When the count is zero, when the buffer is empty. Because there is only one space that you have. You cannot add anything when the space is occupied. So you have to ensure that the count is zero. But this is only an assert. This is not having any weight or signal or anything like that. So we'll need to implement that. The next few slides. Once you put a value, you increment the count by one, and buffer contains the value which is being passed. Get is a similar function. Get will run. So when will the consumer run?
When
the count is one, when there is something to consume. If the count is zero, there is nothing to consume. So assert count equal to one. Count becomes zero, and you return the buffer, which is the value which we have. Does it make sense to everyone? So this is called by the producer thread, and this is called by the consumer thread. So look, we've got a very trivial version of a threaded, multi-threaded program, which is solving the producer-consumer problem. We have a producer thread, we have a consumer thread. The producer runs, it puts some value for loops number of times. Let's say loops, the value of loops is 10. This is an argument passed to the producer. It will put I 10 number of times. It will put 1, 2, 3, 4 till number of loops on the buffer. And then we have the consumer, which gets the data from the buffer. So it's using the same get and the put function, which we defined earlier. But why do you think this program will not run? What is the flaw in this program?
So there's no mechanism to wait in the buffer.
Right, so wait will come in fact second. Is there any basic concurrency mistake that we're doing? So whenever we have a shared variable, we have to
lock.
We have to lock and unlock before accessing the shared variable, right? Everyone with me? Since there is no locking or unlocking mechanism in this system, so it's not going to work. Multiple thread accessing shared resources also. The second attempt is to call mutex lock and mutex unlock before putting and getting. So it solves the first problem of where we were trying to access the shared resource without locking and unlocking. But this also has some block, can you think?
So what if it is executed two times before this?
Yeah, excellent. So there is no notion of ordering, there is no check on how much the producer can produce or the consumer. I'll stop at this point. The next class we can.